If I get too loud, let me know. I have my mother's voice. She can shatter glass at 30 paces. I appreciate the opportunity to talk to you, and I'm trying to figure out something that would be interesting for you. I found that a lot of people are as interested in why you do something as they are what you did. So that's kind of where I'm coming from. My background, I had one professor tell me mine was an ant strip across the sidewalk. Because I started out. I started out in literature. Well, I started out in industrial design. I did 2 years of that, then I found zoology. I did basically a major in that, and then I moved on to literature, so I have a bachelor's and a master's in English, and then I wound up doing a doctorate in education and film, and then put all that aside and started freelancing art in 76. So I started with a pen because I was a science illustrator as a student worker. And they needed, that was before digital, they needed a pen and ink work for our science illustration. So that's what they did. They gave me a pen and a bottle of ink, and away we went. So I'm self-taught, and as a result of that, I stayed with the pen for 40 years and only started painting about 15 years ago or so. So you're going to see that influence. And unlike Taku, who works with his body, I work right here. Basically, it's all about creation, and that's what is that underpins all of our efforts. But what I wanted to show you was I learned some time ago that Carl Jung said art is giving shape to a secret, and all of us have our own secrets, and mine happen to be the kind that most visual artists have. There are little things that you tuck away that become motivations for you. And probably all of you do the same thing. I mean, there are, when I drove to Henderson, for instance, every day I went over Jack Mountain, and there was a certain dead tree that had a particular appeal to me, and often there was a hawk in that tree. I look forward to that hawk. I look forward to that tree. I've driven down streets in Hot Springs just because there's a certain house I want to look at, or there's a certain tree that I like, or there's something like that. Those are the kind of secrets, I think, that motivate all of us in one way or another. William Carlos Williams' poem, The Red Wheelbarrow, I read for years, so much depends upon a red wheelbarrow get glazed with water beside the white chickens. And I looked at that and I thought, what in the world is he talking about? And finally, it dawned on to me when I was working at Indiana University. I would come home in the evening, and I had a two-year-old daughter. And her tricycle sat in the front yard in a blaze of light. And when I came home, it was terribly important for me to see that red tricycle in that green grass. And I think that's what Williams was talking about. And I think that's where the motivations come for much of what I'm doing. These are emotional triggers that reach into whatever mental landscape we have. And that compiles with the cultural influence, the personal experiences, all of that stuff that makes us who we are. And that's where the art comes from, essentially. So these are my triggers. I kind of oversimplified them, but basically, and obviously, they're not one-to-one in the sense that they kind of intermingle, one will influence another. But one is mission, where you know you what you have to do. It might be an assignment, it might be a job, what have you. One is a reaction to something, an experience, or something you see, or something you feel. Then there's cultural play. In my case, literature, mythology, and those kinds of influences were pretty similar. And then there is the most important part of art, which is play. And messing around, trying something, and fiddling with it, and what have you. So anyway, off on the mission. Job like this, is a commission piece by Weyerhaeuser for a promotion they were doing for a trout stream. So obviously, what I have to find in this is how I can enter it, make it something that is mine, and find satisfaction in doing it. In this case, I was working with a retired warehouse engineer who was whistling a fly past my right ear as I was photographing him, so I learned a whole lot about where to stand with fly fishing. Something like this, I've done a lot of portraiture. This is a portrait of Bill Clinton's mother, Virginia Kelly. It was for Chelsea, and that's why it's Chelsea's ginger, which is what she wanted to call it. Those kinds of issues, again, the motivations are pretty direct, so it's mostly about finding something, again, your way into it. This gets more personal. These are the kind of missions that count, okay? My sister Barbie died of cancer. She was fighting head and neck cancer. She was in about the third round of chemotherapy, and out of frustration, not knowing what I could do for her, I'm drawing a lot of fairies and that kind of thing. I had a stack of cards, about 4x6 illustration samples, sitting by my chair, and I picked one up, and I doodled this fairy on it. And as things happened, I started thinking, you know what? I can create this battalion of fairies for her. So what I did was I created 100 of these. And I would send them to her, each one was sponsored by somebody who loved her, including her pets. And each fairy had a job description in her body to do the work. She was a librarian, so this particular fairy happens to be Libra's Lily, that has her own story. So anyway, this is her wall. So I would send to her on a daily basis a fairy and a job description with her sponsor. And they put these up in her war room, and she would sometimes want to know, did I get a fairy today? People came in, they found out they were sponsoring these fairies and didn't even know it. And their names were things like, for instance, one was Hissy Fit, who was Barbie's hairdresser. Well, it turns out, I didn't know this, it turns out the woman's favorite expression was having a hissy fit. So there were several times like that when these kind of overlapped. The names were things like Chemo Patrick, Chemo Kaka, chemo meal tea, on it went, finding these. So this is one. This is Bullet Butt. And Bullet Butt's not to be messed with. She's the start of superheroics in the chemo war. Cancer cells have been known to misjudge her slightly, but it stands for ineptness and have paid the price. Her waist girdle enables her to leap tall buildings, an ability seldom called upon within the confines of your body, but it substantiates her status. For this reason, she occasionally vaults her house for purely egotistical reasons. She's Bootsy Babe's right-hand gal. What these were pretty rowdy, because that was my relationship with her. So they were pretty crazy, and what I would do was I would write the description just contemporaneously, spontaneously, without editing it. I didn't go back and edit because I didn't want to change what I was doing and feeling at the time. So anyway, there are things like chemo caca. Okay, on to reactions. Dreams, I've had a couple of dreams that were significant for me. I'd like to think that I was my age, you understand, right? I wish I was more insightful than this, but it can be dreams, it can be aesthetic arrest, which is a Joseph Campbell phrase that he got from James Joyce, which is that state where it's kind of sublime, where you experience something, the reaction goes beyond thinking about what this is for, or what it means, or what have you. It just knocks you on your can, aesthetically. Events and interactions are obvious, philosophy, emotional responses, and so forth. Probably the biggest category of what's operative. This is Wolfrobe's dream. And I grew up my age playing Cowboys and Indians, and I have a whole romantic thing about the West and what have you. And I had drawn Wolfrobe's face several times based upon a Smithsonian Institute photograph of him. So I had this dream one morning, it was a late morning dream, full technicolor. My wife and I were loping along the side of a slope that was green, like with spring green ryegrass. I looked out ahead, it was a vast plain out ahead of me, and I saw something hit the ground. And I turned back to my wife in the dream and said, "I think I saw an eagle." I turned back again, and there was a huge golden eagle hanging over my left shoulder, just hovering. Rough, feathers rough by the wind, backlighted by the light. I turned back again, and it was Wolfram. And he was sitting on this knoll. And I started up to him, and he said, "Are you afraid?" And I said, "No, I'm just deferential." And he said, "You can ask anything you want to know about eagles, and I can tell you." I said, I want to know how to understand. He said, "You take the wingtips, press them to your lips, and blow. And the eagle will understand." The dream went on and on and on. It was incredibly specific, incredibly detailed. I woke up, I said to my wife, "You're not going to believe this dream." I thought about it for a year, year and a half before I ever did anything. Finally, I drew Wolfrobe's face, hung in the studio for about 6 months, and then I decided how I was going to handle it. But that's the basis of this drawing. And another one, which was basically dreaming about a silverback. And in the dream, he was disintegrating, like in lace. And I thought in the dream, this is environmental. And that was the impetus for this particular drawing. It's called Paradise Lost. My wife and I, when I was teaching in Indiana, reared a screech owl from a little bitty ball of white down to maturity. Fall came, I was going to go to Indiana University. We knew we had to leave the bird. We lived in a hickory woods on a dairy farm, a little bitty old house. I would feed him. He learned to fly in the house. We had all kinds of experiences with him. He liked to take the toothpicks out of the toothpick jar. He jumped in the middle of my wife's fried eggs. He liked to untie my shoelaces. He would ride on my shoulder. He would fly in the house. So finally, we knew we had to acclimate him to the wild. Took us a while to do that. First night, we got him to come out into the yard. He stayed out all night. 5:30 in the morning, he's on the window screen next to our bed. So for a couple of weeks, he would be in the house during the day, he would go out during the night. Then we said, "Well, this is not going to work, and he needs to go." So we took him, and we had a cat, and went for a walk into the hickory woods. And after that, he stayed out, he got wilder and wilder. He would come feed from me occasionally, but was very wild, didn't want to have anything to do with me. And then we didn't see him at all. So the night came for me to load the trailer to move. And I backed the trailer up to the front door, and the first light was on. I'm loading the trailer, and I look up, and he's sitting on the trailer door. And he stayed there all night as I loaded the trailer. I'd feed him a moth now and then, you know, that kind of thing. Closed the trailer up, walked out into the yard, which was pitch black because it was a dairy farm, and you can't hear an owl fly, but all of a sudden his feet were on my shoulder. And he sat on my shoulder as I walked out into that yard until he got up and left. And I swear he was saying goodbye. So this one is titled "The Night It All Came Together." Mary and her husband called me one day and said, there's a hawk that has killed itself flying into our window. I went and got him, and he was a sharp-shinned hawk. And we have a sharp shin around our house. And I have a particular fascination for flight, particularly for birds of prey. So I took his wing, and it's always kind of emotional to take a bird apart. I mean, there's just something kind of painful about it. But I did, I buried him then, and I kept the wing. Wound up writing this verse, even in death, a hawk's battered wing enfurls in its reach for one last dance with the rush of the wind. And the beauty of that wing, even in death, was the striking thing that motivated this piece. Used to walk on the area around my house with my children, near the lake, and there were always red wings, cattails, and the sound of red wings to this day bring back my time with those two girls out on that hill. Lost my sister and my father within 2 weeks. Didn't do anything art-wise for probably 3 or 4 weeks. And one day, paper was on the easel, I walked in, the charcoal was there. I don't know where this came from, but it just showed up. And the verse is, beware our irredeemable loss like a thorny soreness, the dove driven out, the blackbird at home. And it's resignation, and it's about the fact that in death, in my experience, it's like a hole in the blanket. You can still use the blanket, you can even patch it. But there's always the remnants of the whole. And these kinds of things, I don't know where they come from. I don't know that anybody knows. You know, I mean, these are those reactions I'm talking about. This was a reaction to the 9/11 attack and the fall of the two towers. What I remember visually were the repeated views on the news of those walls with the grapes sticking up. And that's where this came from. Same thing, this drawing took about 10 minutes. It was just a real emotional response. A little bit like Taku's talking about when he's painting, where there's initially a physical response that goes beyond thinking and beyond planning. And then there's a refinement process that comes in and pulls that composition together. This is called Charity. It was part of a paint out at the Garden of Gardens. And this is just a purely visual emotional reaction to the beauty of what's there. I was in the St. Louis Art Museum, happened upon this French helmet. I love this kind of thing. I'm a sucker for medieval things. I love the whole wizard and knights and all of that kind of stuff. I'm just a hopeless romantic about that. But I was struck by the beauty of this thing and by the fact that there were dents on the visor. And I just couldn't imagine having that on my head and somebody whacking me across the nose with it. This is just basically a tour de force with a pen. Then there's culture. A lot of association through metaphor. A lot of narrative illustration, which comes as a natural kind of thing for me. And mythology. I love mythology. I love the whole Joseph Campbell take on things. I'm really hooked. One of the myths that I always really enjoyed was Leda and the Swan. If you don't know, Leda was married to the king of Sparta. Zeus, in his inimitable way, fell in love with her. Hera, his wife, didn't approve. He decided he could move in on her if he disguised himself. So he goes as a swan for whatever reason, seduces her. Out of that comes Helen of Troy, and out of that comes the whole tragedy of the Iliad. So part of what I'm thinking about in here is the whole dalliance of power and messing with the divine and arrogance and so forth. But where it really started for me was my fascination with flight. Because I am just dazzled by flight, and particularly feathers. If you think about how weird is it that a scale starts to fragment into a feather, and a feather then becomes a vehicle for aerodynamic motion. So anyway, I'm thinking about Zeus, and I'm thinking about Leda at her bath, and this must be like a divine helicopter coming in. I mean, just, so anyway, this is Leda's song. And I've done three or four shows based on Leda, so that's where this is coming. This is Leda's first feather. Just imagining she's in her bath with her maidens, and there's this little symbol of the feather dropping. That is going to be the sign of what's to come. Pride of Icarus, same kind of thing, the myth, arrogance, flying too close to the sun and the price that it brings. I have a lot of work that has a lot of vines, strings, entanglements. That's all about the whole idea of everything being interconnected. This is all part of that kind of cultural philosophy that comes along and you put together in one way or another. I love vines, like their intricacy. Pandora, of course, another myth along those same lines. I have a little bit of a dark side, as you might imagine. I keep looking at some of the darker elements are in life. My romance with the West extends to the bison. I love bison. This is called Last Rays. I've always been fascinated and a little bit horrified at the fact that we destroyed 60 million animals in a matter of a few years. Ultimately, there were 100 bison left. And the tale goes that when they were at their best with the herds, a herd would be so far across you couldn't see the end of the herd. And you could hear them coming for miles. We rolled out the railroad and the rifles and took care of that. I made a trip to the Southwest looking for cliff dwellings. Again, I like the kind of macabre side of that. I'm fascinated by the Anasazi. I don't understand any more than anybody else does why they fled to the cliffs, why they disappeared like they did. There's a forensic anthropologist in Arizona who believes that part of it was cannibalism, and he has evidence for that, much to the chagrin of art historians and art archaeologists and so forth, but he's pretty compelling. But I love the stonework, and I like the mystery of the passages and all of the kind of implied mystery they have. This is called Quest. Taught a workshop in Oklahoma, part of the West again. Had a lady in my workshop, tall, kind of raw-boned gal, kind of pigeon-toed, walked, you know, and had her narked neckerchief on and a big old black hat on my head. And I was fascinated with her, and I asked if I could photograph her, because I was interested in maybe doing a drawing. And she said yes, so the next day she shows up with a new hat and her scarf and this beaten up leather purse hanging on her. It looked like she dragged it through the gravel, but that was, she was patting that. She was all proud of herself. So this is Oklahoma Louise. Play is a major part of how we learn and is really significant in the creative process. Some of it's just practice, some of it's just design work. This is called Old Muse, Wherefore Art Thou? When I retired from Henderson, I did a show that was based upon real personal kinds of passages and trips and what have you. This was one of them. is called Mark of the Pagan, and this was a transition that came. I did a lot of this tight rendering, which has a lot of planning involved. So I started drawing, just starting out in the middle of the page with a pen. Making a line, see where the line goes. Make the next line, make the next line, make the next line. And a whole mess of these kinds of things showed up. And they're kind of quasi-architectural, not quite. They're a little bit anthropological, a little bit mythological. I did a whole series called Weather Vanes. This is the Weather Vane of the Gods. It was the same thing. I would make sometimes I would just make a series of arbitrary lines on the page, and then come in and start building the composition on those, depending on where the lines led me. I'm a real sucker for those complex. I like gears, and I like loops, and I like that kind of complexity. Sometimes it's just messing around. This is the record. And it's just the fun, having fun with the pen. This is kind of based on, this is called She Who Must Be Conveyed. Kind of based on, you remember the Rumpole series, Bailey the Rumpole, or Rumpole the Bailey?
Yeah, yeah.
And he was always talking about She Who Must Be Obeyed. This steampunk kind of thing is just fun to do. I mean, it's just messing around, seeing what shows up. I did a whole series of these. This is the Bird of Prey. And I did about 15 or 20 of these. And, you know, I would get started on these crazy things. And once it starts, away it goes. I watched David Attenborough's The Deep with all of the crazy, crazy animals down there. And I thought, well, I'll make my own fish. So I wound up doing about 20 or 30 of these. And they began to evolve. They started out like this, and then they became practical. This is the meter reader. And again, it's mostly about just exploring and seeing what shows up. This came out of the same series as Old Muse, Wherefore Art Thou. This is called Future Plans. And I was thinking of my financial advisor. And this comes out of Frankie and Johnny. I've always thought he was a man. I've always thought Frankie must have been a force of nature. Well, this is her. So anyway, that's the end, and the conclusion is every piece is a trek through the wilderness. Every piece has its secrets. Thanks.